Hello guys, we have come to the last topic of this chapter, electrochemistry. Today's video we will be learning about batteries. We have seen how electrochemical cells act as a source of electrical energy. That electrochemical cells can be used as commercial cells. So if you want an electrochemical cell to be used commercially, it must fulfill two basic requirements. The one, it must be compact and portable, and the second one, the drop in voltage in the cell when put to use must be steady and not sudden. It should be a steady flow of current. So these two requirements should be fulfilled for an electrochemical cell to be used commercially. A single electrochemical cell which can be a source of electrical energy is called a battery. Not only a single electrochemical cell, a combination of several electrochemical cells connected in series or a single electrochemical cell is called a battery. Batteries are classified into three types. They are primary cells, secondary cells and fuel cells. Now let's see one by one. And examples of primary cells are dry cell and mercury cell. And examples of secondary cells are lead acid storage cell or battery, nickel cadmium storage cell. And for fuel cells, example is hydrogen oxygen fuel cell. So the first type of cell, primary cells, are electrochemical cells or galvanic cells which cannot be recharged. In other words, the electrochemical reaction cannot be reversed by passing electricity through the cell. So as a result, the primary cell becomes dead after using it for some time. So primary cells are those cells which cannot be recharged. So the first example for primary cell is a dry cell. In fact, the name dry is a misnomer. You know what is a misnomer? It is actually a wrong or inaccurate name. If it has been really dry, it would have never worked. So dry cell, the name is a misnomer. This is a type of Leclanche cell invented by G. Leclanche. This dry cell is based on that Leclanche cell. It consists of a cylindrical vessel made of zinc and is filled with a paste of ammonium chloride to which a little amount of zinc chloride is added. Here, the cylindrical vessel, which is made of zinc, acts as the anode, and a carbon rod in the center of the cell, it serves as a cathode. And the cathode is surrounded by a thick paste of manganese dioxide and carbon. And here, the electrolyte is a moist paste of ammonium chloride and zinc chloride. You can see your textbook for the picture of a dry cell. So in that dry cell, what is the anode, cathode and the electrolyte? Now the reaction is taking place at the electrode when the cell is in use. What happens at anode and what happens at cathode? You know very well, oxidation reaction occurs at anode and reduction occurs at cathode. So when the cell is working, zinc loses electrons to give Zn to plus ions. The electrons given by the zinc pass through the external circuit and are taken up at the cathode. This causes discharge of NH4 plus ions. So these are the reactions taking place at anode and cathode. See, Zn loses two electrons to give Zn to plus and two electron, and these two electrons are taken up at the cathode where this reaction happens. Actually, the reactions that are taking place here are quite complex. So it is just put in a simple way, approximately like this. So at cathode, MnO2 reacts with NH4 plus and plus electron. So this is a reduction reaction to give MnOOH plus NH3. In the second reaction, if you see, the oxidation number of manganese changes from plus 4 in MnO2 to plus 3 in MnOOH. So here actually reduction takes place. The ammonia which is liberated here combines with Zn 2 plus ions to form a complex ion which is called as diamine zinc 2 cation. This dry cell can generate a steady voltage of nearly 1.5 volt. During working, the zinc container, the cylinder which is made up of zinc, is slowly consumed because the metal is involved in the reaction. Even when the cell is not working, the acidic ammonium chloride, which we take here, this is acidic in nature, corrodes the zinc vessel. So it is likely to develop holes, which leads to the leakage of the current. So to avoid this, the zinc container is covered with a thin sheet of another metal, which is inert to cell reactions. Such cells are known as leak-proof cells. We use these dry cells in flashlights, which are torch lights, and also in portable radios. These dry cells are used. Now the next example of primary cell is mercury cell. It is a new type of cell which finds frequent use in small electrical devices such as hearing aids, watches and cameras. These mercury cells are also called as button cells. In this cell, anode is the zinc mercury amalgam, a cylinder made of zinc and mercury. When these two are mixed together, we call that as an amalgam. And cathode is a paste of HgO and a carbon rod. And electrolyte is a paste of potassium hydroxide and zinc oxide. So what happens at anode at cathode? At anode, oxidation happens. See, ZnHg plus 2OH minus gives ZnO solid plus H2O liquid plus 2 electron. And at cathode, reduction happens. So the overall reaction can be written like this. Zn plus HgO solid gives ZnO plus Hg. See, this H2O and this H2O can be cancelled, and 2OH minus and 2OH minus can be cancelled. So this is the overall reaction. This mercury cell gives a cell potential of 1.35 volt. If you see the overall cell reaction, it does not involve any ions whose concentration may change. Therefore, this cell gives a constant potential throughout its life. So if they ask you why the potential of mercury cell is constant throughout its life, because the overall reaction involves no ions whose concentration may change. However, the cell after use should be disposed of in such a manner that it does not cause pollution, because mercury compounds are extremely poisonous. So we have seen about primary batteries and two examples of primary batteries. And you know, primary batteries are those electrochemical cells which cannot be recharged. And now we are going to see secondary batteries. Secondary batteries or cells can be recharged on passing electric current. They are also known as storage cells or accumulators, because electrical energy can be stored in them. Two examples of secondary cells are lead storage battery and nickel cadmium storage cell. So the first one that we are going to see is lead storage battery. It is used in automobiles, and the voltage of individual cell is only 2 volt. Therefore, 3 or 6 such cells are joined in series to get a 6 volt or 12 volt battery. If you want a 6 volt battery, 3 such cells can be connected in series, or if you want 12 volt battery, 6 such cells are connected in series, because individual cell voltage is only 2 volt. So here the anode is a grid of lead filled with spongy lead, and cathode a grid of lead packed with lead oxide. And the electrolyte here in lead storage battery is 38% solution of sulfuric acid. When the cell is in use, these are the cell reactions happening at anode and cathode. See, at anode, Pb solid plus SO42 minus, this comes from the sulfuric acid to give you PbSO4 solid plus 2 electrons. So oxidation happens at anode. And at cathode, PbO2, see, we have lead packed with PbO2. That PbO2 reacts with SO42 minus, again it comes from sulfuric acid, plus 4H plus, that also from sulfuric acid, plus 2 electron, because this is reduction, to give you PbSO4 plus H2O liquid. So the overall reaction is Pb solid plus Pb O plus H2SO4. See, 4H plus plus SO42 minus together is written as sulfuric acid to give you 2PbSO4 plus 2H2O liquid. From this equation, it is obvious that H2SO4 is used up during discharging, which means when the cell is in use, H2SO4 is being used up. So what happens? The density of sulfuric acid falls. It can be measured with the help of a specific instrument. So when the density falls below 1.20 gram per centimeter cube, the battery or cell fails to generate electric current any further. So now it needs recharging to work again. During recharging, the cell is operated like an electrolytic cell. What is an electrolytic cell? You give energy to make a redox reaction to happen. So now electrical energy is supplied to it from an external source. So now this cell is going to act like an electrolytic cell. So these are the reactions happening when the cell is being recharged. These reactions are reverse of those during the discharging, which means when the cell was in use, you wrote a reaction. When the cell is being recharged, the reverse of these reactions happen here. See, PbSO4 solid plus 2 electrons here gives Pb solid plus SO4 2 minus. Same way, this cathode reaction, look here, the reactants are written here on the products are written here on the reactant side. PbSO4 plus 2H2O liquid gives you PbO2 plus SO4 2 minus plus 4H plus plus 2 electrons. Now see the overall reaction, just the reverse of this reaction. So now you can see here in the product side you have H plus and SO4 2 minus. What is this? This is the sulfuric acid. Recharging is possible in this case because the PbSO4 formed actually is a solid and sticks to the electrodes. Therefore, it can give electrons during recharging. So same way, you can see during charging, water is consumed. While discharging, water is released. So this water can be used up while charging. So there is no necessity to add water from time to time. So after charging, you get back this sulfuric acid. So again, it starts working. So you should be careful while writing the cell reactions at electrode, whether it is asked while the battery is in use or while the battery is being recharged. And now the next example of secondary cell is a nickel cadmium storage cell. It has a longer life than lead storage cell. It is used in cordless appliances like phones, pagers, electric shavers, mobile phones, and it has a potential of 1.4 volt. In this battery, cadmium acts as the anode and a metal grid containing NiO2 acts as the cathode and electrolyte is KOH. So these are the reactions occurring at anode and cathode. Cd solid plus OH, 2OH minus gives you CdOH twice plus 2 electrons, where this is oxidation. And at cathode, NiO2, which is reacting with 2H2O, taking up 2 electrons because this is reduction to give you these products. So the overall reaction is this. Cadmium plus NiO2 plus 2H2O. You are not writing this OH minus and 2 electrons because this 2H minus and 2OH minus gets cancelled out, and this 2 electrons and this 2 electrons can be cancelled. So you have CdOH twice plus NiOH twice. Just like a lead storage battery, these reactions can also be reversed while charging. So secondary cells are those electrochemical cells which can be charged and reused. Now we will see the third type of cells, fuel cells. We studied about primary and secondary batteries. Primary batteries contain a limited amount of reactants. The moment these reactants are consumed or used up, the cell cannot be used anymore. The secondary cells can be recharged, but the process takes a long time. So these are also not very useful. Fuel cells have been developed to get rid of these limitations I stated now.
These fuel cells can work as long as the fuel is available. This means the fuel cells are basically primary cells in nature. Because as long as you keep on giving the reactants, they can generate electricity. So you can define a fuel cell as a device which converts the chemical energy of a fuel directly into electrical energy. Such conversion is possible because the combustion reactions are also redox reactions in nature. An example of fuel cell is hydrogen oxygen fuel cell. The hydrogen oxygen fuel cell consists of three compartments separated by electrodes which are made of porous carbon. We use catalysts like finely divided platinum or palladium in the pores of the electrodes in order to accelerate the chemical reactions that are taking place. The central compartment contains aqueous NaOH or KOH which acts as the electrolyte. Now, gases hydrogen and oxygen are bubbled through the pores of the catalyst. And now these reactions take place at anode and at cathode. See, 2 hydrogen gas plus 4 OH minus gives you 4 H2O plus 4 electron. So hydrogen undergoes oxidation at anode and oxygen undergoes reduction at cathode. So the overall reaction is 2 H2 plus O2 gives you 2 H2O. As a result of this redox reaction, electricity is generated. This cell can work continuously as long as the fuel. What is the fuel here? Hydrogen and oxygen. As long as these fuels are available, these cells can work continuously. So the fuel cells are basically electrochemical cells. So this makes the fuel cell better than primary as well as secondary cells, because these fuel cells can work continuously as long as the fuels are supplied at the electrodes. And the second advantage of fuel cells, these cells do not cause any pollution problems. They do not release carbon dioxide or any other undesirable gas. The only product is water, and it is used for drinking purposes. This hydrogen oxygen fuel cell was used by Apollo space mission, and the water we get here as the product was added to the drinking water source for the astronauts. We all know that coal and petroleum are most commonly used fuels, but these reserves are getting depleted at a very fast rate, and it is a problem to meet the fuel problem both in industry and aviation. And apart from these depletion, they have resulted in serious health hazards also, because these fuels produce poisonous gases such as carbon monoxide, oxides of nitrogen and sulfur. When they are released into the atmosphere during combustion, they are very harmful to the living beings. And scientists are making efforts to find an alternate fuel. Hydrogen in the liquefied form is probably the best answer. This dihydrogen in the gaseous state as well as in liquefied form releases more energy on combustion as compared to the other fuels that are commonly used. So this is a better fuel. And we have also seen combustion of hydrogen produces very little pollution. So hydrogen fuel cells can be used to generate electricity, even to run electric powered cars. Because you know, a fuel cell produces electricity from a chemical reaction just as in a battery, and can work as long as hydrogen and carbon are present. We are talking about hydrogen fuel cells. In the case of hydrogen oxygen fuel cells, we take hydrogen and oxygen. We use both oxygen and hydrogen. In the hydrogen fuel cell, we are going to use hydrogen as the source of fuel. Liquid hydrogen can be used as rocket fuel because it gives higher upward thrust as compared to other fuels. So we have seen commercial batteries under three topics: primary batteries, secondary batteries and fuel cells. Now we have come to the last topic of this chapter, corrosion. When metals are exposed to air or kept in the open for some time, their surfaces are slowly eaten up or corroded. You could have seen iron gates getting rusted. This happens because of the formation of certain compounds like oxides, carbonates, sulfides, etc. by the gases and water vapors present in air depending upon the nature of metals. This is known as corrosion. However, metals like gold or platinum, which are known as noble metals, are not affected. So, corrosion may be defined as the process of slow eating up of a metal by the gases and water vapors present in air due to the formation of certain compounds. Here we use the word metal. If that metal is specifically iron, then we call this chemical process as rusting. So rusting is also corrosion. When it is corrosion of metal, we call that process as rusting. Here rust is hydrated ferric oxide and it is brown in color. You would have seen in iron gates or rods which has been exposed to rain. It may be noted that corrosion or rusting, once started, continues till the whole of the metal is consumed. So it eats up the entire metal. Now let's see the mechanism of corrosion with the help of rusting of iron. This mechanism is based on the electrochemical theory, since it involves the formation of small electrochemical cells on the surface of ion. So the surface of the ion acts like the miniature galvanic cells. So in this miniature cell, the water drops containing dissolved oxygen and carbon dioxide from the air, they act as an electrolytic solution in which oxidation reduction reaction takes place. The ion present in the metal act as anode and releases electrons which take part in the reduction reaction. So a small electrochemical cell is set up on the surface of the metal. Now let's see one such cell, what happens at anode and cathode and how rust is formed. Let us consider this box as the piece of metal. So it is made up of iron. So this iron acts as the anode, iron atom. It undergoes oxidation by giving up two electrons. See, this happens at anode. Fe solid gives Fe2++ two electrons. So these electrons released by the iron atoms participate in the reduction reaction and they combine with H+ ions. See, these electrons from here, see here two electron, all this four electron combines with H+ ions in the presence of oxygen. So this H+ ions come from carbonic acid, and that carbonic acid is formed by the combination of carbon dioxide and water present in the surface of the metal. Not only from carbonic acid, directly from H2O also H+ can come. So that H+ combines with this electron released at the anode, the presence of oxygen, to give water. So the net reaction can be written like this: 2 Fe2+ plus 2 H2O. Okay, this H4H+ plus O2 is nothing but H2O. So Fe2+ plus 2 H2O gives 2 Fe2+ plus 2 H2O. Sorry, O2. Fe 2 Fe plus O2. This is H+ from the carbonic acid and in the presence of oxygen, and these electrons are released from the anode. So the overall reaction is 2 Fe plus O2 plus 4H+ gives you 2 Fe2+ plus 2 H2O. So these oxidation and reduction reaction happens on the metal surface. Now what will happen? This Fe2+ ions are oxidized to Fe3+ ions, which combine with water molecules to form hydrated ferric oxide. And this is nothing but the rust. It is a brown mass. So a small electrochemical cell is set up on the surface of the metal and anode and cathode reactions happen, and finally you get Fe2+ which is oxidized to Fe3+, and that Fe3+ when it reacts with water molecules comes out as rust, and the formula for rust is Fe2O3.xH2O. It is also called as hydrated ferric oxide, and it is a brown mass. This is the rust. Every year, a lot of money is wasted because of this corrosion, and also accidents happen because of the bridge collapse, because we use iron rods in constructing bridges. When this iron rods get corroded, they lead to accidents. So this corrosion should be prevented. We follow different methods to prevent this corrosion. Two such methods are barrier protection and sacrificial protection. The purpose of barrier protection is to create barriers between the metal surface and the moisture or water drops, so that they do not come in contact with each other. You can do this by painting the surface using certain chemicals like bisphenol, or you can coat the metal surface with oil or grease. This type of protection is called as barrier protection. The another way of protecting the metal surface from corrosion is sacrificial protection. In this method, the surface of the metal to be protected, for example, if you want to protect the iron, it is coated with a more reactive metal. When you coat the surface with more reactive metal, here in the case of iron, you can coat it with zinc, and we call that process as galvanization. Here, zinc being more reactive than iron, you can see in electrochemical series, it occupies a lower position than iron. So zinc being more reactive, it will take part in the redox reaction and will save iron. In other words, it will sacrifice itself for the sake of the metal to be protected. This process of coating iron with zinc is called as galvanization. And that's the end of the lesson. Here I have written the reactions from where you get that H+ in the cathode reaction. I told you the electrons are released from anode, which means from iron atoms. They take part in a reduction reaction and combine with H+ ions. That H+ ions are released from carbonic acid. How do we get this carbonic acid? Carbon dioxide reacts with water from the atmosphere to give you carbonic acid, and this carbonic acid gives you dissociates to give you 2H+ to CO3 2-, and this is the source of H+, and also you have water. From that water also you get H+. These H+ combine with electron to give H. That H, 4 of that H combines with oxygen to give you water. This is the overall reaction written at the cathode. 4H+ plus O2 plus 4 electron gives 2H2O liquid. And finally, the Fe2+ is oxidized to Fe3+, which combines with this water to form hydrated ferric oxide, which is the rust. And that's the end of the chapter, electrochemistry. Thank you.